Greetings, students, and welcome back to part two of this lesson on the ethics of sex and gender. I am Dr. Michael McGowan. Let's jump back into it. All right, in the first part, I went through some preliminary remarks. I called us to civility, and of course, all those comments apply to this lesson as well, maybe even more so. We went through some terminology. We talked about the difference between biology or anatomy and gender identity. And then we went through the old debate, the debate people were having from, one could say, the 1960s until the 2010s, when the debate shifted from positions on sexuality to the politics of sex. Now there are arguments about gender identity and other controversial moral issues related to sex and gender, which we will get into now. All right, the new debate has to do with gender identity and fluidity. The idea that gender is not this binary thing. And as I mentioned in part one, if you get a chance, you should watch the MIT Free Speech Alliance debate on whether gender is binary. It's a fantastic debate. It's important. There are different voices from all sides represented, and it was just a really good and helpful debate if you want to understand the positions. All right, on behalf of transgender people, let me make a few comments. Gender dysphoria is real, right? Gender dysphoria is real, and it is basically a discomfort in one's biological sex. The sex one was assigned at birth. And I happen to be what is known as a cisgender male, right? And a straight, white, cisgender male. And so I have limited understanding of what this is like. But from all indications point to, it is a really difficult condition to live with. The DSM-5, it's kind of like the manual for psychologists, right? The DSM-5 talks about it this way, quote, clinically significant distress or impairment related to gender incongruence, which may include desire to change primary and or secondary sex characteristics. Now the rates, as it relates to how many people actually deal with this, the rates are disputed. It could be anywhere from 1 in 1,000, which is 0.2%, right? 1 in 1,000 to, I don't think that math adds up. 0.2% to 1.5%. It is not entirely clear because, well, for reasons we'll get to in the next slide. Suffice it to say, the rates are disputed here. 0.2% to 1.5%, and we're not sure how many or what percentage of people are actually going through this. The result is that a person's body feels wrong. You know, like I said, I don't fully understand what it is like to feel this. I have felt, overweight. I have felt out of shape. I have felt tired. I have felt a lot of things, but I've never felt like I'm in the wrong gendered body. And if you haven't either, maybe it's time to get to know someone who's different than you, you know? So the result is that the body feels wrong. It's also worth mentioning that this shows up mostly in boys, ages 2 to 4 years old. Most end up outgrowing it, you know. Boys 2 to 4 years old might wear different clothing. Most end up outgrowing it. 70% of them end up becoming gay men if they're not kind of steered towards a different outcome. Most end up just becoming gay men. But there's no way to know early on who is going to outgrow it and who isn't. There are some reasonable requests that I think deserve to be mentioned on behalf of transgender people. Think about, especially if you're not a transgender person, think about what you would want if you were. Wouldn't you want just to be accepted by virtue of your humanity? Don't you have a right to be seen and simply to exist, right? Simply to exist, to be treated equally under the law. Don't you have the right to be treated equally under the law? So if there's a crime for one person and a crime for another person, if you're a victim of that crime and you happen to be a transgender person, you still deserve justice, you know? If you want to get married to whoever, you still have the right to get married if you want to, You know what I mean? These are reasonable requests just to see and exist and be treated equally under the law. Being transgender, the argument goes, being transgender is no reason to deny someone, you know, a lease to an apartment, to deny someone a mortgage. It's no reason to deny someone a job. It's no reason to, you know, deny someone employment. These seem like reasonable requests to the people who make them, just to be seen, to exist. Now, the transgender movement is a different sort of thing, and we'll talk about it on the next slide. This is seen, you know, as the new civil rights era of our day by people who are activists on behalf of transgender causes. So let's talk about the other side of this coin. We could question transgender activists. I think it's okay for us to question transgender activists because in this class we're interested in, you know, giving both sides of every story. And so notice I'm not questioning transgender people. I'm questioning transgender activists who distort facts or disrupt proceedings, whatever. Look at some of these stats. In 2007, there was one pediatric gender clinic in the United States of America. There was just one. And by 2021, what is that, 14 years later, there were 300 pediatric gender clinics in the United States. Is that to say that in those 14 years, there was a 300 times increase in the amount of cases of transgender minors? What does that mean? What does it mean for our society that there were 300 in 2021 and only one in 2007? I think you could argue one thing that it means is that we are more tuned into the actual struggles that people are going through. And of course, some of those cases would have been, you know, victim of shame and abuse and all that. So more clinics mean more people can get the care they need, but it also might mean that there's a social contagion element to it, right? Medical and academic societies give this gender-affirming care without enough information or studies. If it is the case that 70% of the people who display signs of, you know, gender dysphoria early in life, if it's the case that 70% outgrow it, well, what should we do about gender-affirming care that involves irreversible activities without enough information or without enough studies? It's worth asking. Any responsible society should ask, what do we do with children in this new era we're in? So let's differentiate three groups of people. There are, as I've mentioned, people with actual gender dysphoria, transgender men and women. Historically, it's been less than 1% of the population. These people deserve all the respect. They probably don't want your sympathy, but they do deserve respect just by virtue of being human, you know, the right to be seen, etc. There is a second group that deserves to be mentioned. And any, like I said, anyone concerned about kids should be concerned about this. There has been a 4,400% rise in the rates of transgenderism among teenage girls. This is this idea that there is some social contagion happening. And the problem is that if a minor goes on certain drugs, and like I'm not a doctor, so I don't know the details of some of this stuff. If there are any drugs that they end up taking, puberty blockers and then hormone therapy, right? If it's possible that infertility could result later, well, that's a major, major issue. And it is something that we should potentially protect kids from themselves. The kids who decide, you know, maybe they see their friends experimenting. Maybe they see that, you know, other people got attention by being transgender for a little while. I've had students in classes who say, I was several years ago, I'm no longer. Imagine if everyone who displayed signs of transgenderism was given all the medications, some of which are irreversible, and then they wanted to change their minds when they became adults. How would they do that? They can't, right? Some of this stuff might be irreversible. So it's worth mentioning this second group, teenage girls. There's been a 4,400% rise in rates. What does that mean? Why is it happening? It's not to take away from the people who are actually going through this. It's simply to say that a society needs to care about its teenage girls. And if some of them end up wanting children later, this matters. All that I'm saying is that it matters. If they might want to have children later, if they change their minds later, maybe they should be prevented from doing anything irreversible before that time. There's a third group of people, and this relates to free speech. The transgender activist community can be quite passionate, right? I don't know if you've watched any comedy specials by Dave Chappelle lately, but he has taken particular issue with transgender activists. And I wonder if he's onto something, right? Could the activists from this community be riding a wave of protests without realizing that some of their activism is insufficiently ordered, shall I say? It is potentially, I remember seeing a video clip of, a state senator, I forget which state and I forget when it was, who in the middle of regular proceedings, in the middle of operating, their own state's Congress, she was basically shouting at people and raising her fist and disrupting the proceedings. I think they ended up trying to get her out of the state Senate or state House. I don't remember how it all played out. But there is an element to the transgender activist community that is unwilling to countenance difference of opinion. And so that's what makes me lecturing about this actually pretty fraught. There will be some people who take issue with the fact that I'm even offering a slide questioning these transgender activists. But I think any responsible society should try and hear from all people and then come to a position that respects everyone's dignity while at the same time protecting our members of our society. All right, there are other controversial issues in this ethics of sex and gender, one of which relates to, as I said, the politics of sex. That image on the right, I took that in November of 2008, the night that Barack Obama won the presidency. I think I took that the very night he won the presidency. I was in West Hollywood. I didn't know anything about West Hollywood. I had just moved to California to start my PhD. And I went into this bookstore. I didn't know West Hollywood was like a big gay area or whatever. So I went into this bookstore not knowing it was, I didn't know there were such things as gay bookstores. A bookstore could be gay. But anyway, I took this picture because I found it interesting. The Advocate was presenting non-traditional sexualities as the last great civil rights struggle. Interesting, right? So one of the questions involved with the ethics of sex and gender has to do with politics. And part of a political conversation in the United States has to involve liberty. So religious liberty and anti-discrimination laws. What are we going to do when a person's religious liberty conflicts with laws that prohibit discrimination? This is something we've dealt with already, and we're likely going to deal with it for the foreseeable future. There was a baker, I think it was in the state of Oregon, a baker who was a really dedicated, really passionate Christian, believed that their faith did not allow them to support gay marriage. So when a gay couple came in asking this baker to bake them a cake, they refused. And so the gay couple took them to court saying, look, if you're a business, you got to be open for everyone. And yet they said, our religious liberty allows us to make decisions about what causes we will or won't support, and we don't support that. Now, of course, the United States has struggled for a long time to live up to its founding creed that all people are created equal here. So what are we going to do? What are we going to do about religious liberty and anti-discrimination laws moving forward? It's not entirely clear. Where is the line between religious liberty and anti-discrimination? Could someone make an argument to the baker to say something like this? Look, if you want to have a religious vocation, that's fine. Start a nonprofit, give your stuff away for free. If you're a nonprofit, that's one thing. You are a for-profit business, and that means you have to abide by anti-discrimination laws, right? Could that be an acceptable response to the baker who says, no, my religion won't let me do this. That's one issue. Another issue has to do with sex on demand. All of us have phones in our pockets. This wasn't the case 20 years ago. All of us have phones in our pockets. There is the illusion of sex on demand nowadays. And one question is whether or not this is healthy for a society or hurtful. Imagine the kind of images of women that a lot of young men are receiving through pornography, right? And I'm not mentioning this to be a prude, but just to ask the question, what does this do for male-female relationships if young boys come to expect that women are going to be this way or that way? And even worse, what happens when they become so involved with these false images, this illusion of intimacy online, they become so enamored with that they actually lose all confidence and can't talk to any actual real women. Oddly enough, from Generation X downward, sex is declining. People are having less sex than they used to. Why is that? Well, one of the reasons might be because people are having their sexual, you know, quote unquote, needs met in solitary ways. And that has not been the case in the past, nearly to the extent that it is now. A third issue that has happened in the last 10 years, and this has been a monumental leap forward for women, right? Sexual power differentials and harassment in the workplace. It is simply unacceptable and morally repugnant. It's morally disgusting when someone uses a position of power to take sexual advantage of another person. This was the great insight of the Me Too era. And if I had a daughter, I would want her to speak up if anything ever happens like this. Sexual power differentials in the workplace are real and they happen. And thankfully, they happen a lot less now than they did 10 years ago. Because nowadays, women aren't going to take that shit, right? They're going to report it, and rightfully so. Finally, part of that sexual power differential and part of the advance of the Me Too era, there is a dark side, right? There are times when someone could make an accusation and use that accusation as an attack, right? Is it possible that someone could use a sexual assault or harassment allegation to attack or smear a person if she or he didn't do that thing to that person? Could accusations be used as attacks? And of course, the answer is yes. The question is, what do we do about it, right? There are a number of different perspectives out there. One is we should believe anyone who accuses someone else of this stuff, because something like 98% of them are legitimate, instances of there was a real sexual assault or a sexual harassment situation, and less than like 2% is someone trying to use an accusation as an attack. So that's one perspective, just believe the person. Another perspective is, withhold judgment until you do a full investigation. Another perspective is, those might be the two main ones. I don't need to go into any more. All right, so these are four more issues that we're dealing with having to do with the ethics of sex and gender, religious liberty and anti-discrimination laws, sex on demand, or at least the illusion of it, sexual power differentials, and someone potentially using accusations of sexual assault or harassment as an attack, and which is especially nefarious if the person who is being accused of something didn't actually do it. All right, that's all I wanted to cover in part two of the ethics of sex and gender. If you have any questions or comments, you know how to reach me, and thank you for watching.